Hello, people of the world. We are Anonymous. This is an update on Operation Global Blackout. After 72 hours have passed, Mega Upload has not been reinstated back to the internet. This has greatly outraged us. But by now you're probably wondering, why hasn't any of the things stated in the initiated video happened yet? Simple. Because this proposed idea doesn't have a set period of time of when it will go into effect, as it is an ongoing operation. Like I said, it was a raise in awareness. I explained what we can do, not what we will do. Shutting down the sites all at once would not only have a negative effect on the internet itself, but the economy as well. The economy is something we must preserve in times of depression. I assure you, this was not a hoax. This was not a prank. We still have access to the servers of said sites. Crashing them now is not a plausible response to the current Mega Upload situation. If you think Operation Global Blackout has been withdrawn, you are mistaken. It can never be withdrawn or cancelled. It is an ideal operation that we can choose to launch at any said time we feel deems necessary. I hope that with this announcement, you as people have alerted your level of consciousness, updated your ways of thinking, preparing for the upcoming cyber war. We as people have great ideas constantly, to which some will never be shared, thus making us all anonymous. Are we not? Support the cause. Protest in the streets. Call your local congressmen, governors, senators, and other politicians. Spam the White House with the letters of our oppression, for Anonymous is in the hands of us all. We are not a group. We cannot be joined. No one person speaks for us. We are an idea that binds us together as one shared entity. We as people must raise up and fight back against those working behind the scenes to strip us of our rights. The voice of the weak will be heard by many. Government of the United States of America, you have been warned. Operation Global Blackout, ongoing. We are Anonymous. We are Legion. We do not forgive. We do not forget. Expect us.
Congress is considering legislation that would give companies a free pass to monitor and collect communications, including huge amounts of personal data like your text messages and emails, and share that data with the government and anyone else. All a company has to do is claim its privacy violations were for cybersecurity purposes. H.R. 3523, also known as the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act of 2011, would let companies spy on users and share private information with the federal government and other companies with near total immunity from civil and criminal liability. It effectively creates a cybersecurity exemption to all existing laws. There are almost no restrictions on what can be collected and how it can be used, provided a company can claim that it was motivated by cybersecurity purposes. That means a company like Google, Facebook, Twitter, or AT&T could intercept your emails and text messages, send copies to one another and to the government, and modify those communications or prevent them from reaching their destination if it fits into their plan to stop cybersecurity threats. Worst of all, the stated definition of cybersecurity is so broad, it leaves the door open to censor any speech that a company believes would degrade the network. The bill specifically mentions that cybersecurity can include protecting against the theft or misappropriation of private or government information, including intellectual property. Such sweeping language would give companies and the government new powers to monitor and censor communications for copyright infringement. It could also be a powerful weapon to use against whistleblower websites like WikiLeaks. Congress wants to use the threat of cybersecurity to undermine our digital rights. Tell your lawmakers that we won't stand for dangerous, unsupervised information sharing in this bill or any bill like it.
To the citizens of the United States of America. We are Anonymous. We would like to inform you that despite our attacks on SOPA and PIPA, and despite our victory in destroying these bills, there is a new threat. the more bills that are passed that target both the people and our domain, the internet, the more we will commit to stand our ground and defend it. Unlike CIPTA, however, we, as a collective, are taking a direct stance. Cispa, the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act of 2011, and those who have crafted this bill have now become sworn enemies of Anonymous. The people have to stand with us. The companies will not this time, as the bill conforms to them. It will not be the same for the people. This time, we will be on our own. We will unleash the worst pain on those who threaten our existence. You will neither eat nor sleep without hearing our voices through your walls. Your actions will be monitored. We are not as you thought we'd be. We will show you our legion's extent. We will march through the streets. We will destroy your reign of terror on our domain. You will cease to exist. This is not a threat. This is a promise. We will defend our home. Operation Defense Engage. We are Anonymous.
We are Anonymous.
We are Anonymous.
We are Legion.
We are Legion.
We are Legion.
We do not forgive.
We do not forget.
You should have expected us.
An onrush of condemnation and criticism kept the SOPA and PIPA acts from passing earlier this year, but US lawmakers have already authored another authoritarian bill that could give them free rein to creep the web in the name of cybersecurity. As congressman in Washington, consider how to handle the ongoing issue of cyber attacks. Some legislators have lent their support to a new act that, if passed, would let the government pry into the personal correspondence of anyone of their choosing. H.R. 3523, a piece of legislation dubbed the Cyber Intelligence Sharing and Protection Act, or CISPA for short, has been created under the guise of being a necessary implement in America's war against cyber attacks. But the vague verbiage contained within the pages of the paper could allow Congress to circumvent existing exemptions to online privacy laws and essentially monitor, censor, and stop any online communication that it considers disruptive to the government or private parties. Critics have already come after CISPA for the capabilities that it will give to seemingly any federal entity that claims it is threatened by online interactions, but unlike the Stop Online Privacy Act and the Protect IP Acts that were discarded on the Capitol building floor after incredibly successful online campaigns to crush them, widespread recognition of what the latest would-be law will do has yet to surface to the same degree. Kendall Berman of the Center for Democracy and Technology tells RT that Congress is currently considering a number of cybersecurity bills that could eventually be voted into law, but for the group that largely advocates an open internet, she warns that provisions within CISPA are reason to worry over what the realities could be if it ends up on the desk of President Barack Obama. So far, CISPA has been introduced, referred, and reported by the House Permanent Select Committee on Intelligence, and expects to go before a vote in the first half of Congress within the coming weeks. We have a number of concerns with something like this bill that creates sort of a vast hole in the privacy law to allow government to receive these kinds of information, explains Berman, who acknowledges that the bill, as written, allows the US government to involve itself into any online correspondence, current exemptions notwithstanding, if it believes there is reason to suspect cybercrime. As with other authoritarian attempts at censorship that have come through Congress in recent times, of course, the wording within the CISPA allows for the government to interpret the law in such a number of degrees that any online communication or interaction could be suspect and thus unknowingly monitored. In a press release penned last month by the CDT, the group warned then that CISPA allows internet service providers to funnel private communications and related information back to the government without adequate privacy protections and controls. The bill does not specify which agencies ISPs could disclose customer data to, but the structure and incentives in the bill raise a very real possibility that the National Security Agency or the DoD's Cyber Command would be the primary recipient, reads the warning. The Electronic Frontier Foundation, another online advocacy group, has also sharply condemned CISPA for what it means for the future of the internet. It effectively creates a cybersecurity exemption to all existing laws, explains the F, who add in a statement of their own that there are almost no restrictions on what can be collected and how it can be used, provided a company can claim it was motivated by cybersecurity purposes. What does that mean? Both the F and CDT say an awfully lot. Some of the biggest corporations in the country, including service providers such as Google, Facebook, Twitter or AT&T, could copy confidential information and send them off to the Pentagon if pressured, as long as the government believes they have reason to suspect wrongdoing. In a summation of their own, the Congressional Research Service, a nonpartisan arm of the Library of Congress, explains that efforts to degrade, disrupt, or destroy either a system or network of a government or private entity is reason enough for Washington to reach in and read any online communique of their choice. The authors of Cispa say the bill has been made to provide for the sharing of certain cyber threat intelligence and cyber threat information between the intelligence community and cybersecurity entities, but not before noting that the legislation could be used, and for other purposes, as well, which, of course, are not defined. Cybersecurity, when done right and done narrowly, could benefit everyone, Berman tells Wright. But it needs to be done in an incremental way with a narrow approach, and the heavy hand that lawmakers are taking with these current bills, it brings real serious concerns. So far, Cispa has garnered support from over 100 representatives in the House, who are favoring this cybersecurity legislation without taking into considerations what it could do to the everyday user of the internet. And while the backlash created by opponents of SOPA and PIPA has not materialized to the same degree yet, Berman warns Congress that it could be only a matter of time before concerned Americans step up to have their say. One of the lessons we learned in the reaction to SOPA and PIPA is that when Congress tries to legislate on things that are going to affect internet users' experience, the internet users are going to pay attention, says Berman. H.R. 3523, she cautions, definitely could affect in a very serious way the internet experience. Luckily, adds Berman, people are starting to notice. Given the speed that the latest censorship bill could sneak through Congress, however, anyone concerned over the future of the internet should be on the lookout for Cispa as it continues to be considered on Capitol Hill.
The protesters over student debt is new here in the U.S., but over the last year and a half, we've seen thousands of students coming out to protest tuition hikes and university privatization in London, Chile, and just last week in Montreal. They've all turned violent. Earlier, I spoke with Robert Applebaum, founder of ForgiveStudentLoanDebt.com. I asked him why we don't see students coming out in droves to protest the outrageous student debt crisis in this country. Why did it take the debt to hit $1 trillion before seeing actions like this organized on the ground? Here's his take.
Unfortunately, here in America, I think there is a significant stigma of shame and embarrassment when it comes to debt and student loan debt. Also, there are very few recourses for people with student loan debt. So, you know, taking to the streets and protesting about it won't, you know, it's a demonstration that people are upset about it, but why aren't they coming out in droves? It's because they know that there are no consumer protections on these loans. There's no statute of limitations on the collections of these loans. And they're basically stuck with them for life. So I think people in this country feel defeated. And given the nature of our politics, I don't think that they see an opportunity for anything to really change.
Yeah, but why do these people see the opportunity for change in other countries? I mean, it's the same issue, the privatization, the outrageous debt, the raising cost of tuition. I just don't see why this country is so different.
I wish I had an answer for you. There's just something in the American psyche about, you know, wanting to pay back what you borrowed and not really wanting to admit that you're in such dire straits in terms of debt. I just think there's something different about the American psyche.
I think it's the American dream, still thinking it's achievable. You know, we go to college, get our dream job, and I think that a lot of people still think that this is the road to take, and when it doesn't happen, you're right. I think there is an element of shame maybe to that and in denial.
Absolutely. They blame themselves.
And
they blame themselves for not achieving the unachievable American dream.
We just saw on the campaign trail, you know, this is a hot topic. Romney and Obama are both agreeing on keeping the interest rates lower and not having them double. What do you think that wouldn't that just put the $6 billion burden on the taxpayers, though? I mean, if we absorb the cost of the interest rates not raising or doubling like they're scheduled to do, what would that do? Isn't that just a vicious cycle?
Well, you know, at a time when the biggest financial institutions in this country, who nearly destroyed the economy 4 years ago, can borrow from the federal government at 0% interest, I see no reason on earth why students who are merely trying to obtain an education should have to borrow at 6.8%. Even the 3.4% interest rate is higher than what the biggest financial institutions in this country have to borrow.
There's a vote this week about this. What do you think is going to happen with it?
Well, from what I understand, Speaker Boehner recently came out and said that there's going to be a vote. However, they're going to extract the money from payments on Obamacare. So, you know, it's just more political posturing and more political games. Ultimately, if that's the stance that the Republicans are going to take, then nothing's going to happen, because obviously the Democrats aren't going to defund Obamacare. And the Republicans, obviously, in the last 2 years, have demonstrated a willingness to really dig their heels in to the detriment of the middle class.
And talking about political posturing, do you think that what Obama recently said about how, you know, he and Michelle just got rid of their student loans 6 or 8 years ago and just finally got their debt forgiven or expunged, do you think that there's truth to that? I mean, or do you think that he's just politically pandering to the student vote?
Well, I don't think they're mutually exclusive. I think you can politically pander and be truthful at the same time. And I think it's a matter of record that he and Michelle did take out student loans to attend both college and law school. And, you know, until 8 years ago, he wasn't even on the national scene. So I don't really have any reason to doubt that he just finished paying off his student loans 8 years ago, because that's just about when he made his famous speech at the 2004 convention. Well, nominating John Kerry when he came onto the national scene.
Well, I would argue that he was on the national scene a little bit prior to that. But, I mean, is there anything that he can legitimately do to curtail these predatory industries? Or, I mean, is it just kind of out of his hands?
Well, it's out of his hands solely. We need Congress and the president to work together to actually accomplish something. The president can only do so much on his own without a Congress willing to do the job that it was elected to do. But what they can do is get behind a terrific piece of legislation that was authored by Representative Hanson Clark of Michigan, H.R. 4170, the Student Loan Forgiveness Act of 2012. That sets up a new repayment standard of 10 years of repayments at 10% of your discretionary income, and the remaining amount is forgiven. That is a piece of legislation that can really curtail the abuses of the student lending industry and really get us a long way towards economic growth. Because right now, as it stands, with $1 trillion of outstanding student loan debt, we have a significant suppressive effect on the economy. As a result of these debts, those people who we rely upon to buy houses and to buy cars and to start businesses and start families aren't doing any of those things because of their student loan debts.
Yeah, it definitely is going to require working together with the whole establishment to really, you know, take this to the next level and give students a chance to really pursue their dreams and take back the American dream. Shifting the conversation really quickly, you know, looking at a university like Harvard, where tuition is, I don't know the exact number, but about $50,000 annually. Why are these universities, you know, private and public, given these tax-exempt statuses, and they're just continually gouging students, and tuition costs just continue to raise year after year? It just seems counterintuitive when we could be having them pay kind of a portion to get us out of this mess.
Well, you're preaching to the choir. So I completely agree with you. You know, and I think ultimately the root cause of the problem with skyrocketing tuition, counterintuitively, is actually the existence of student loans themselves. Because of all of this seemingly free money, where anyone with a pulse who wants a student loan can get one, the lenders don't have to engage in any sort of risk-benefit analysis. And the colleges and universities have no incentive to keep their tuition down because they know ultimately they're getting paid up front and the students are going to be left holding the bag.
You know, and to wrap up this segment, Robert, half of every college or half of college graduates in 2012 were unemployed. I mean, is it time to start reconsidering higher education? Where do you see this going?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I am personally a proponent of public funding of higher education. The 21st century equivalent of the high school diploma is the bachelor's degree. And if we accept that premise as true, then cutting off public funding of education after the 12th grade is completely arbitrary and does not reflect the realities of today.
That was Robert Applebaum, founder of ForgiveStudentLoanDebt.com.
Well, readers of Time magazine have cast their ballots for the year's most influential figures across all fields, from politics to tech and pop culture. And the winner is Anonymous. The group of hacktivists surged to take the top spot just before the voting ended, easily beating out Eric Martin, the general manager of the online sharing community Reddit. So should anyone be surprised that Anonymous is so popular? This is how they describe themselves.
You could argue that the most powerful people on Earth are a bunch of nameless, faceless 17 to 35-year-olds. It's like the hacker ruling class, right?
One voice. It's not individual voices. That's why we don't show our faces. That's why we don't give our names. We're speaking as one, and it's a collective.
Now, the group shot to fame over the last year or so. In that time, they've taken on greed, corruption around the world, and they have seemed to have a soft spot for the Occupy Wall Street movement.
Hello.
We are Anonymous. If you have not heard about our brothers and sisters on Wall Street, we are currently experiencing our own Tahrir Square moment. However, this is not enough. We have other cities that we, the people, must occupy peacefully to let the world know the people are winning. Next month marks a momentous shift in our history. Everyone, everywhere will be occupying their towns, their capitals, and other public spaces.
Now, some online observers are not buying the results. An unnamed source told the social media site Mashable that Anonymous had most likely hacked the vote. On Twitter, Anonymous called the claim, quote, complete rubbish, and then tweeted, dear, that's the handle, at Mashable, ever stop to think maybe we're leading because, I don't know, people like us and actually voted for Anonymous? Ouch, sounds like Mashable got smacked down for talking trash. While the readers have spoken in Time magazine's top 100 influential people poll, the magazine will have the final say when the results are released on April 17th. It will be interesting to see if Time will follow the will of the people.